It's funny, as you get older, you should see more. You tend to think that you'd see more and you'd experience more, but I think in a way you see less, because we know at this point what we like and what we don't like, you know? When I was younger, I didn't know, so I'd try anything. I'd go anywhere. And I'd be disappointed half the time. I'd be like, God, this sucks, get me out of here. But I would go. And, you know, a bunch of the time I would find myself in situations that were new to me and experiences that I hadn't had before. And that happens less when you get older, because you become more selective and sort of wiser about decisions. But the drawback to that is that you experience less, you see less, less new things especially. And I'm thrown together with these 8 beard guys. And they're cool people, doing different things than I am. Inspired by different things. Making decisions that would never even occur to me. And they're attractive decisions, man. Some of them are great. I love it. If anything, I'll know one thing. I'm coming out here and I'm doing some camping in this ridiculously beautiful terrain.
Well, here we are, man. This is gonna be my last sleep with my beard. Yeah, yeah. That's cause for celebration.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, man.
That's right.
This will be the last
Fuck
time.
Yeah, man.
I wake up with drool all in my face,
oh,
having to
God.
Wipe it out. It's so awful.
We'll have to enjoy our last meals too.
Oh.
I should have brought us some kind of a sandwich. Because it's the fucking bane of my existence, man. Still, I haven't had any in months.
Yeah.
I look at them and I want them. Sometimes I make them and then I cut them up with a fork and knife. And I have to maneuver it around.
And you eat it with a fork. You sandwich with a fork.
Yeah, I miss them. I miss sandwiches, you know.
Necessarily, but I don't want to shave. You know what I don't want to end about the shaving thing? Is I don't want to stop doing this. Yeah, that's it. I'm losing a voice. I'm losing part of my voice. I had a window where I was able to talk in a way that I hadn't necessarily done. I mean, this is essentially what I do in my journal. I just write a bunch of crap. Stream of consciousness. And I've actually stopped writing in my journal since this whole thing began. It's about a lot more than the beard, you know? It's about It's about 6 months. It's about a chapter. It's about a time of my life.
I kind of was expecting the Hollywood narrative. I was expecting a big beginning, middle, and end, and that wasn't what happened.
No.
That's not the way life works, you know?
I had a lot on my mind, I guess. I guess I recognize that you're a good person to talk to, man. I've just been wanting to get it out.
Even if in your own estimation you say that it wasn't a good beard, it was a fine beard. And if you just lost this, you got a fucking amazing goat.
I do have two more questions. Are you working right now? You have a job?
Yeah, I do have a job. I get tuition paid and some salary from TAing a class, which requires 2 hours a week of teaching one or two poems to 40 freshmen and sophomores at UC Davis. Grading all their papers when they turn them in.
Well, looks good.
Here we go.
Let's get started.
Yeah.
More teaching, more writing. And a winter garden coming in. As Samuel Johnson said, you know, you want to know what another man is thinking, you know, look inward. And there it is. We tried growing our beards, you know, a couple years ago. And shaved them off, frankly, because we thought they looked like shit. So.
That's the truth.
As much as this is going to be construed as, like, sort of this bonding project, you know, I don't feel like that has anything to do with it for me.
I don't think Emily Dickinson was a poet until somebody else found that box of poetry under her bed and read them. Then she became a poet. Before that, she was just a wacko who lived up in her room.
The pile of folders is
about a week and a half of papers that I have to grade for my writing classes that I currently teach. You know, they call us in the press like freeway flyers or you know, there's a variety of nicknames for community college teachers who try to cobble together a living teaching at two or three or four or five sometimes different schools all at the same time. So I do five classes right now at three different colleges. Divorced, which was a good decision on both of our parts. And I did get a great kid out of that relationship who I have split custody of. A few years later, remarried, a woman who I'm married to still and will be married to hopefully for a very long time. My parents are truck drivers. They both drive in the same big rig truck back and forth across the country, occasionally venturing up into Canada. The poetry thing turned me on in a big way. And I figured, well, I'll do that. I'll write novels, I'll write poems, I'll make a living doing that somehow. And that just never really panned out. You know, I thought that I would be a filmmaker because I was really interested in the visual arts and I was really interested in writing, and I figured, perfect, like, I can make that happen. And I wrote three novels. I keep thinking about revisiting the last one and finishing it up, but that never quite panned out either. You know, the trick is moving from one career to the next without falling into a economic chasm that enslaves you to what you thought was your dream.
Had I been writing songs, sitting in here for the last 2 years, as much as I've been doing carpentry, I might sort of not be as wild about songwriting. I've been doing so much carpentry, my hands are calloused and my back hurts. I've been working really hard. I was born again Christian when I was 12 till I was about 20. And then realizing that I didn't really necessarily agree with or believe or understand all of the things that are entailed in that when I was about 20 or 21, there was something of a schism in my mind, and I kind of had to really not be a Christian in order to figure out what I believed. So now I'm at a point where I go to church, not always, but I know I believe, I just don't know what I believe. There was a hard period of years for my dad where he was working really hard and not getting much return. He calls them the lost years. Actually, I remember asking him about it, and he said there's 20. I asked him about, you know, what was it like when we were growing up, and I was 15 and 18 years old, and he was looking back at it, and he just said, I don't really remember those years. 20 years, he just worked. I don't think he was very happy then. I guess what I'm getting at is there's a strange thing that has happened in the last 2 years is that that I haven't played, I stopped playing. I still consider myself a songwriter because it's the one thing that I do that I know is true to me somehow. But I haven't been doing it. So I have a wrestle. I love to do it. And I think that having felt that I've sort of lost that in the last couple of years is terrifying. So now I'm just reducing it to a like. My dad is sort of spiraled into the beginnings of Alzheimer's. My mom is, well, sort of slipping in her own way.
Mentally and physically. Mentally, I'm just dopey.
You are?
Yes, completely. I have a very strange feeling all the time.
What is it?
Wobbly. I'm wobbly.
In your brain or?
No, my body.
Oh, so physically?
Even lying in bed, I'm...
Oh, no. What is that, Dad?
I don't know. It's something very strange. I've asked the doctors about it, and they don't know either. And then I forget things, too. I forget things, every day.
You know who I am?
Mom?
You know who I am?
Yes, of course. Read, my God. I know you very well.
What kind of, you want to go get some food? Are you hungry?
Oh, yes, indeed.
What would you like?
Oh, I think anything pasta would be good.
Anything pasta?
Yeah.
All right, Pops. Mom's outside. We're going to go see her.
Okay, good.
That's a picture of you, Dado, when you're my age.
Yeah.
It's not so much that I dislike having the beard as it is I despise not being clean-shaven. I only discovered on my 30th birthday, and I don't mean like around the age of 30, I was literally at my parents' house, and looking in the mirror, and I saw what I thought was my parents have two dogs, I thought it was one of the dog hairs, and I thought somehow it had, you know, lodged in my ear, and I pulled it to pull it out, and I went, oh my God.
it was
attached. And it was pretty disheartening because I felt like I wasn't going to start until I was 70, you know. My bike somehow broke in half at the age of, you know, 8 or 9, and my grandfather welded it. And that's a profound act. I mean, as a kid, you don't understand what happens when your bike breaks. You don't understand the economics of it. You don't understand, you know, my parents were renting in this shitty house. And they didn't have any money. Like, they probably couldn't afford to buy me a new bike, right? So my grandfather welded the bike, and I think that probably had some effect on my perception of him. He was in this nursing home, and I said something to him like, wow, you're still shaving, huh? I said, have you ever grown a beard? And he said, no. And I find that, frankly, I find it kind of sad. I think it's kind of depressing. That's an essential experience as a man. And I don't mean stop shaving for 2 weeks when you're on vacation in, you know, Utah, going skiing, right? Reading books on the beach in Cuba. I mean growing a fucking beard.
I think that's an essential male experience. And I'm excited to be doing it.
Coming back from Vietnam, like a lot of guys, I'm sure, let their hair grow, grew their hair out, kind of, had just for 2 years had to shave every day. So his hair was quite long. His beard was, well, like you'll see with mine, was quite large and kind of came out in this shape off to the side. And the day I was born, he's a very symbolic guy, and he likes to kind of create his own symbols. So he decided that his new child would somehow be inextricably linked with his beard, or even be his beard. I think I'm kind of in my dad's beard in a way, because he shaved his face clean, came to visit my mom in the hospital, and she didn't recognize him because she was very sick. The birth was really difficult, and she kind of looked up at him. And so the story goes, she said to the woman next to her, "I think he's yours. He's not mine." Mm-hmm. And he said, "No, you know, it's sweetie, it's me." And that was the last time he shaved, and it's been 33 years.
I'm getting some weird light in from the sun. It's making, I'm sure, some weird spots on me.
Oh man, yeah, that's way too much light. Maybe over there's better.
No, it makes me look like a ghost. Well, the sun's starting to come up, as you can see.
Oh, there we go. I'll do it down here.
Much better. And master's at UCLA. Moved to New York, Boston, and Chicago. A couple of years ago, performing with Blue Man Group. God, I can't get this glare off. I'm teaching drama and English. And so directing the plays at the school is cool. I'm getting married in July.
I'm sitting on the floor now. That'll be better. Yeah, that's much better.
The longest time I've ever gone without shaving is about a month. I tried two different times to grow a beard, and I gave up because it became far too ridiculous and cumbersome to deal with.
I am not allowed an interviewer. I am to speak directly to the camera. For an hour.
I'm not a Mormon. I grew up Catholic. And I'm not a polygamist. Nor are any of my friends a polygamist. I don't know any polygamists. I don't know anyone who would want to have more than one wife, really, quite honestly.
So you're married?
Yes, I've married. And actually, yesterday was my 6th-year anniversary.
Oh, wow. Congratulations. Yeah.
Thanks. I know every parent probably thinks this of their children, but I think she's pretty smart, you know? She seems to be pretty savvy. And, you know, hopefully we'll do a good job raising her and she knows right from wrong at least. Look, Addie, no hair.
Kiss your daddy's face.
Look, no hair, look. Addie, look.
Hey, Dad.
I'm here.
How you doing?
I'm keeping quiet when I'm cold, but if I move, I'm hot.
If you move, you're hot?
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
Well, I have to warm up.
I bet you're plenty warm.
I'm warm now.
You've got a fully insulated Carhartt bodysuit.
Yeah.
You've got your North Face. I don't know what brand this is, but you've got your super warm jacket.
Yeah.
You got your Russian hat. You want me to pull the flaps down for you?
Well, no. Well, everything helps against the wind.
Yeah. How's this?
Yeah, it's fine.
All right. We are setting up the shooting gallery. And the thing is, Dad, we're going to roll you over there, and we're going to put an apple on your head.
It's been a painful process seeing him the way I see him now compared to the way I saw him when I was 15. I mean, my dad and I were remarkably close, and still are. And I'm very lucky to have a connection with anyone in this world like the one I have with my dad. My dad really is a Willie Loman character in that he has a remarkable ability to see the good in things and a very limited ability to see the bad. You know, he's broken his hip, he's in a wheelchair, he can't walk, he's incontinent, he's broke. And you ask him, you know, in the morning, "Hi, how you doing, Dad? How's it going?" He's, "Oh, wonderful. I feel very enthusiastic today about it. It's going to be a very good day, you know." I don't know how he does that.
Sad. I love these trees. Yeah. I suppose I should talk about how this is relevant to the beard. I mean, I guess that it just makes you feel like you should have a beard when you do things like this. Guys with beards should cut down trees. My dad and I planted these trees when I was probably 10. I don't know. No, I was older than 10. I was maybe 12. These trees have always been here. They were very small. They were, you know, just little pups back when we first planted them. Alberta spruce, I think that's what they are. I thought that I wasn't watering it correctly because the other one, the first one, died, and this one still looked beautiful and green. And Lottie said, were you aware this other tree died? And I wasn't aware. It happened so quickly. So I thought I was not watering it because it was the end of the summer. But you know, these are pretty well established trees and they've never needed water before, you know, ever since they were very small. So we started watering the shit out of them, and the other one still died, and this one still died, even though it's been raining. So I'm no expert, but you know, I think it's got to not be lack of water. I think it's got to be some sort of bug or something, maybe a worm. I don't know.
When you're 80 years old, you're like an old tree that has, where you can see every single time a growing branch had to change its course because another branch was in its way, or because it had to grow through a fence and up and around. It has a gnarled bump every time the lightning struck it there, or the caterpillars attacked that. Or, I mean, there are these war wounds in this. Great hulking tree that creates sort of a roadmap of its last 100, 200 years. And I see that in my parents. I see I see their lives. I see their mistakes. I see their regrets. And maybe the worst part is to see those things through a haze. And my parents sometimes become ambivalent. because the burden of the pain or the prospect of changing is so daunting and I mean, I so daunting and so terrifying that they would rather be miserable in something that is that they know.
I live in the suburbs. I mean, the real suburbs. Shitty, shitty suburbs. Suburbs are shit. So I'm turning on my street. Passing food source. Food source over here. There it is, it's food source. There is a certain sense of sort of anonymous life here that I guess could be appealing, perhaps. It's not appealing, but it could be.
You know how we go outside and we go hiking?
Yeah.
Do you like when we do that?
Yeah.
Why do you like that? Is it fun?
Yeah.
And you like climbing on rocks and seeing all the flowers and the trees and the sand? Do you like that?
Yeah.
It's fun, huh?
Yeah.
Do you know how important that is?
Yeah.
That's one of my goals, is to spend more time with you in nature.
Oh.
Yeah?
Yeah.
This time of year, they sort of replace the leaves on trees with blinking lights. It renders everything a little magical. Our neighbor has strung up white icicle lights on the side of the fence that borders ours, which I appreciate, but he seems to have gotten some of the blinking out of phase, so it appears that we have some sort of marquee or liquor store or something, or a motel across the way, because it's blinking back and forth. I don't know. You don't tell him that, of course. You know, it's good to see an old guy up on a ladder putting his Christmas lights up.
I don't much like Christmas at this point in my life. It just is a period of total economic ruin every year, and I don't want most of the crap that I get for Christmas, nor do I much want to buy anybody anything for Christmas. And the bottom line is, it's not just, you know, abstract bitterness, or at least I don't think it is. It's just that it seems like kind of a pointless process to go through. I've sort of ceased to find the meaning of it. And I've ceased to be able to really connect with it in any way that makes any sense to me. So it's coming up again. I'm going to be financially ruined again every year, and there's nothing I can do about it. I just try to put on my best happy face and go on with business. But the reality of it is, it's not it's not something I look forward to.
Beard's fine. The beard is in a good place. I realize you can all see the beard. That probably wouldn't agree with me. Probably all glad you don't have this beard, but I like this beard. Keeps the neck warm. It's like a scarf beard. I save money on scarves.
Well, I'm in the mood for coffee.
Oh, okay, let's go get a coffee.
That's the thing I love to have in the morning.
Well, it's 6 o'clock at night, Pops.
Oh, I see, okay.
So what are you in the mood for?
And it's coffee again.
Out on 7th Avenue, he held her close, like she might fall if he let go. He held her in, he shut the door. Our eyes met in the mirror. To angle wood, just take it slow, was all he said. Across the span, we pulled away,
I know it well, this old ballet, finding the flow, mind in the sway, catching green lights all the way. I brought them home, I brought them home, I brought them home in that cruel, cruel spring, and where's the rain? The wells have all run dry, and the reservoirs have reached an all-time low. And if this red light ever turns, if I make it through the park, I'll head uptown for the last fare of the day. Turn it does, pull away. I know it will, this old ballet, finding the flow, mind in the sway, catching green lights all the way. And there they are, outside St. Luke's, with their flowers and balloons, all amazement at the baby in her arms. As Amsterdam makes us a place, I ask about her name, and we all laugh when he says hope and she says grace. And then it starts, the angels give. I know it will, this old ballet, finding the flow, mind in the sway, catching green lights all the way. I brought them home, I brought them home, I brought them home.
Is this your favorite day of winter so far or what?
I brought them home in that clean, clean.
I think the purpose is to talk about dreams in the, you know, in the subconscious context, you know, when you're sleeping and all, but for some reason I feel compelled to talk about my dreams, my aspirations. You know, I go through it every day if I'm doing the right thing, or if I'm going to make it, if I'll be successful, or, you know, my wife and I have been talking about getting pregnant again. We just got back from California, where we went to the doctor, and we went to a fertility clinic where they basically were planning on correcting a problem that my wife was having, and you know, that wasn't allowing us to get pregnant. And so we're going to start trying to have another child again soon. And man, I tell you what, that's a scary thing sometimes. I think it's great. I think that having another child is going to be a wonderful thing. It's going to be really difficult. You know, it's going to consume our lives essentially for the next several years. But I feel strongly that Addison needs a brother or a sister. I mean, if for nothing else, I'd do it for her. She's an incredible kid, and I don't know what I did to deserve her. You know, that's the other thing with bringing a child into this life. How do you bring a child into this life when you're afraid that 50 years from now we're all going to be at each other's throats, living in a fucking wasteland?
I gotta go see my dad. I have really just brushed that whole thing under the rug in the last couple weeks. It's just happening. What can I do? You know, I guess the idea is that every time I call, tell him I'm coming, he's excited, but he doesn't remember the next time I talk to him. So he doesn't know. It's weird, though. He slips in and out. He does know, but he doesn't. It's not like he doesn't have the faculties to tell me what he knows or when, but I think somewhere in there, he knows.
Hey. What's up, Dado?
Hello, me.
You sleeping?
Yeah. Oh, I'm dying.
Good. I came and I'm...
My dear brother.
No, son.
When did you get here?
Son.
Your family.
I'm your son. I'm not your brother.
I'm all my family.
I know, Dado.
Oh, yeah.
What's up, Pops?
I'm dying. I love you.
You too, Dado.
Speaking of drugs, I mean, I can't remember the last time I really used a drug recreationally. I mean, that's a bald justification for the way I do use drugs, which is when I'm alone and I want to study something or write something that wasn't sinking in or wasn't hitting the right rhythmic note when I was sober, you know. I feel like I'll drink a beer. I feel like with beer you're not using a drug until you've had about four. And I rarely go over four lately. And when I used to go over four, I was aware that I was living in a story. You're not living in a story when you crack a beer with your Mexican food. But you open number eight, and you're, you know, pushing rocks down a hill with your buddy or something. You know, or you're having a wild existential argument with your girlfriend, then you're living in a story, and it's a drug. And I would argue it's not an end to itself. You're not just trying to get loaded. And I think any time you decide to get loaded, it's because of what's happening in your life. And probably if you're a storyteller, then that's also part of a story. But beer, weed, coffee, tobacco here and there, wine, soft stuff, you know, but always to an end.
It's that time again, the watchman in the crow's nest totters down. As he falls asleep, he sings, please, please take me over now. I'm falling back to the shore. Please, please take me over now. I'm falling back to the sea again. Oh, please let it be over now. I'm calling back to the sea.
I'd have to say this beard has seriously affected my intimate relationship with my wife. She doesn't like the hair. And the fact that I have no upper lip. Usually when we kiss, I just stick out my bottom lip and say, here, find a soft spot and kiss it. I would be interested in having sex sometime soon. That'd be nice. I can't blame the beard on everything, but yeah, it's definitely
I wouldn't say put a strain in our relationship, but, you know, relationships are always much easier when you're having sex. You know, you can forgive the little nuances, you know, the little nitpick things that you know, normally don't bother you. When you're not having sex, they tend to grind your nerves a lot more.
I'm writing poems again. It's a sports term called false hustle. It's where you, let's say a ball's hit into the outfield, and you get a real good read on it. And you get a pretty good jump, but you don't need a good jump. So you act like you're fighting the sun maybe for a second. And then you sprint at the last possible moment and dive flat out to catch the ball. And they're usually kind of lazy, looping liners down the line. The crowd goes wild, the chicks dig it. Manager pats you on the back. But there'll be two or three players on the team and on the other team. They kind of go, he could have caught that standing up. You know. That's how I feel when I'm writing poems, you know. Feel like I could have done those lines better service, putting them in stories. I don't know, I guess it's just, there's something ultimately too showy about my lame-ass poetry.
This is, let me get this over here. From this angle, right, looking straight on, I feel like it looks like a real beard for the first time. From now I have a beard. How's that?
It's just awful. It's like when I'm eating food, I'll put a big bite of food in or something, and then I won't realize that I've bit down really hard, and it tugs and pulls one of the hairs in, and it feels like I'm being stung in the face.
You know, I was talking to Christian last night, and I thought, okay, here's the thing. Like, we could make this worthwhile. We could make every guy come on and talk about his mustache. And we say, if you trim, you have one of two options. You trim, you're out of the film, or you shave off your eyebrows. So if you're gonna trim your mustache, the eyebrows go too. Bye.
I do not want Jeff Pitcher to be president at all.
No, you guys would never.
If I see a guy just
me
like
to,
me,
no.
I just go, all right, he likes to play music too much. He probably drinks a little too much. He doesn't know money matters very well. Like, it's always been very baffling to me that so many people say, oh, well, George Bush is just like us. We can relate to him. And I just
That's,
feel like,
no, you're totally right.
I want somebody
right.
running the country
totally right.
that is so different from me.
Totally right.
I want to feel like the person running the country is intelligent beyond my comprehension.
Yeah.
I want them to speak eight languages. I want somebody who's very diplomatic, that can relate to businessmen and laborers. And
well,
I just don't understand the idea that this person should be just like
I mean, can
you
imagine George Bush talking to somebody from a different country? I can't even
picture.
Well, no, I
can't really.
You can.
Have you had the dream where you've shaved?
Yeah, man.
I figured everyone had, but like,
so,
I've had two dreams now where I'm like...
So what happened?
The first dream, I thought,
Oh, shit. Okay. If I don't see picture for another 4 weeks, because it was early on, I was like, I might be able to pull this off. It was like in the dream I had shaved, and then and as soon as I was done shaving, I was like, oh, fuck, I wasn't supposed to shave. I was just doing it as my normal, like, okay, every 4 weeks I shave thing.
Right.
I thought, oh, shit, man, I wasn't supposed to do that. So I was going to try to, like, lay low as long as I could, you know, and then I woke up and... Oh, good, I have...
No. Oh, good, I have my neck beard.
I have my neck hair still.
I got my neck beard still.
Do you look like, I mean, this just happened to me tonight. Like, when you're in the shower or whatever and you see a razor, and it just, like, kind of like that same thing. Like, you want to pick it up and shave, you know, but then like, you're, like, you're frightened that you might actually do it.
It's like that moment when you're driving, and you feel like going... Yeah. On the highway. Yeah. Like, it's some strange animal. I don't know what it is, right? Yeah. You know, it's funny. I've had two shaving dreams. One of them is sort of gone from the recesses of my brain. The other one involved you. And I don't know, I can't remember the circumstances, but I shaved, and I had the same thing after I shaved and went, oh, fuck. Explain.
It's like a dream where you kill someone.
Yeah, I felt so fucked up. I did the exact same thing. I woke up and went, I kind of rolled over. My heart was beating really fast, and I kind of laid there for a while awake. I started laughing.
I don't know. I can tell you that I feel as if I spend 90% of my time wanting time to run out as quickly as possible. Example, I spent every semester waiting for the semester to end, only to have there be a new semester. I spend the beginning of the year waiting for the end of the year. I wish I could figure out a way to be more available to myself in terms of accepting what I can and cannot get done, but frequently my life is spent as it is right now, driving from one job to the next. And that shit will wear your ass down pretty fast. It really will.
Apparently, one of us has decided that the beard had to go. And I gotta say, I don't know who that is. My first impression is that it's someone with a woman in their life. And I don't know, I guess there's lots of women among the nine of us. Or men or women.
The only people that I can give reason to have possibly shaved would be gonna be either Lanny or Perez.
I almost feel really sorry for that person. Cause they came this far, you know? And then they came this far and they didn't see it through for whatever reason. That would bum me out. It bums me out. It makes me sad. I just seem to feel really overwhelmed with kind of a sadness, you know?
If I had committed to this project and I backed out at the 3.5 month mark, I wouldn't feel okay with that.
I have to admit, I'm a little disappointed. I'm a lot disappointed. But, you know, everybody has their reasons for doing anything they do in life. You know, I don't know. Who knows? Who knows what the hell causes, you know, grief or strife in someone's beard growing?
Then it could have been Ben. Ben is another one who... Ben seems to be his own dude. You know, his... a very, very solitary soul. I don't know if that's the correct way to put him. I was really impressed with Ben. I liked him a lot. But I would get the impression that he doesn't necessarily... That one day if he woke up and didn't want it anymore, he would just shave it.
one of us is not even, I don't know, is not one of us anymore. If it was just a fuck it, I'm gonna shave thing, that's, I think that's bullshit. I think that's disrespectful to all of us.
Discovered I can etch a sketch like the wind blows in the Sierras in winter, you know. I have a talent, man. I got a talent. It's true. Everybody says it, man. I can rip off a call it a work of art. I can rip off a work of art on that etch-a-sketch in 2-3 minutes, man. I mean, I'll do your portrait. You'll want to figure out a way to freeze that thing, you know. You want to drain the beads out of it or whatever the hell you got to do to preserve that image. You'll want to give me $60 for it or whatever an etch-a-sketch costs these days. I don't know. I feel like what I need to do is maybe do the blow dry thing, you know. Condition it, lock it in with the heat, you know. Pretty sure that's what happens, you know. That's what happens. I'm not really sure what they do with blow dryers anymore, because it's been a long time since I even held one in my hand. But I'm pretty sure that they lock the conditioner into the beard, into your hair, and you know, whatever kind of hair you're doing. I'm sticking with that. That's my thing. The Etch-a-Sketch was a revelation, for sure. I pity you, Mike, man. You gotta watch some of the most boring fucking shit on this thing, you know? I'm sorry. I hope it's worth it to you. I hope you end up, you know, I wish you the best, man. I hope this propels some sort of, you know, low-level editing job somewhere for you. mine eyes have seen. Mine eyes have seen the glory, glory. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. She's peeling down the alley in a black and yellow Ford. She's coming back from swimming at the local reservoir. Seen her taking off her clothes along the sandy shore. Let me tell you, boys, it was a sight mine eyes beheld. The burning bush between her legs I accidentally yelled. Well, she saw me up behind the rocks and she beckoned I come down. But I ran like a scalded dog and made it back to town. Where the taverns would not let me in, though I pounded on their doors. So I came back behind the church and had a drop of yours. But not before she caught me and she yanked me in the ford. Mine eyes have seen the glory
of the coming of the Lord.
As humans, we set ourselves up and we were sort of doomed to repeat the same cycle of things, the same cycle of historic, of emotional train wrecks that we live in, or financial fiascos. I find it amazing that in this world, so often, people are not doing what they want to do. They're not with the person that they want to be with. They're not satisfying parts of them that need satisfaction. Why don't we do what we want? What we're supposed to do. We're satisfied with 16th place. So yeah, I'm good here. At least I got benefits. I can't be that. I cannot be that. You know, I just can't be 80 years old and look back and say, God, man, I never went for it. I didn't go for it. I see songwriters singing that are just, you know, just unfortunately for them, they just don't have anything to say. And they don't sing very well. But they're going for it, man. And I watch them and I'm proud for them. You know, it's like, yeah, you suck, but you're going for it. You know, that's better than what I got. I'm building cabinets. It'd be one, you know, don't get me wrong, building cabinets, I love it. And someone who was born to build cabinets and does it and is doing it and saying, man, this is it. I found my calling. That's the most noble, honorable thing in the world. I couldn't see. Problem I got is that I'm faking it. I'm building cabinets, but that's not what I'm supposed to be doing. I'm just passing time. I'm just paying my bills. You know?
Scared to be close to me. There's something behind your eyes. What else can I do? What more can I say till I reveal to you the love in my heart, mi corazón, mi corazón.
You know what? I think Mom's probably better at this than I am. What do you think?
Cool.
Is that what you think?
Just what happens when I stop shaving, you know? It's nothing to be coveted.
Okay, there we go. Okay.
I'm doing the big one.
Alright, so, we're supposed to talk about cars, fuel, driving, things like this, and if we have any stories.
You know, I don't get it. Personally, I don't understand. Who needs a $60,000 automobile?
Jesus, Jeff wanted us to talk for an hour about this.
Daddy? I'm too for something
more. It's not that I have anything against religion. I think religion is probably necessary for some people.
I go to the store and somebody drives by in a truck, and this just happened walking out of Long's the other day, or walking into it rather. Some people drove by in a truck and some guy leaned out the window and said, "Rad beard, dude!" And And he meant it. I mean, I could tell the guy meant it. He was giving me the thumbs up. Yeah, way to go! I mean, I didn't really do anything. I just stopped shaving. This is just what grows out of my face, but I guess that in and of itself is quite a feat for some people.
I realized that there was an odor, that I was smelling my dinner. And what I was smelling was food that was stuck in my beard. I mean, not food that was stuck in my beard, but like remnants, you know, butter or sauce that had sort of worked its way in a little bit.
People have been asking me a lot this week if I've trimmed it. I've gotten a few people. Did you trim your beard? I don't know. It's definitely longer here, but it's not filling out in my face at all. The only place where I really have a beard, like a beard, is on my chin. This is the only place where I consider it a beard. This is all just hair growing off my face. It's not, you know, here it coalesces into a solid mass. And I just noticed that really recently.
Today, my wife almost gave birth 2 months early to our new baby. She went into labor pretty much, or preterm labor, and we had to go to the hospital, spend all day in the hospital getting the contractions to stop, which they did, which was good. And then we were sent home with, she's got to take some oral medication, and now she's on total bed rest, which means she can't really do anything. What that means is that I can't leave her at home ever with the kids without another adult here, so, well, at least with the younger kid, Emerson. I'm not entirely sure how to get through this next couple of months at this point.
This was morning terror, where I woke up and just saw the frailty of all the things that I've got. Sometimes my brain just opens a door and lets me see how tenuous lots of things are. It's like different aspects, different things going on in my life are these big bubbles. And I've got to keep, or balloons, and I got to keep them up in the air. I got to keep them up. And if my attention is diverted and I focus too much on one thing, all the other ones are slowly going down. And if they hit the ground, they'll pop. So I got, you know, I'm juggling. I got my parents and my whole deep sadness at their situation, feeling of powerlessness in it. And I got to, there's so much that I feel like I could and should do.
Today has been a very shitty day. And as of right now, this very moment, I'm not particularly fond of this beard anymore. So in the last month and a half, my wife and I have purchased 2 cell phones off of eBay and received 2 broken, no good for nothing, piece of shit cell phones. I'm tired of the way people treat me. It definitely brings about a change in people. You know, just because I'm bearded and hairy, people just assume that I'm a redneck or someone who just doesn't have any intelligence whatsoever. I'd rather take that cell phone and shove it right up that guy's ass. And if not his ass, just cram it right down his fucking throat. Then again, I look like Jesus, too. I got that comment a lot, so I don't know, maybe it all went straight to my head. Who knows?
fuck, we got 3 more months to go. 3 months. I don't know how I'm going to eat between now and then. At some point, I'm going to be doing these interviews, and you won't even be able to see my fucking mouth. It'd be like having a fucking sock puppet up here. I'll be able to talk, and I can be just like a ventriloquist. I can just hide my lips behind all this fucking hair, and nobody will ever see my mouth move. I'm just a sucker. I should have fucking sucker written right on top of my head. That's really what it all boils down to. I'm too nice. Hey, if anybody is looking for somebody to just kind of push over, I'm your man. I'm the nice guy who never fucking wins, it seems like. I'll probably be that way my whole life, and it won't amount to hill of beans. I really miss my wife kissing me. I mean, she seems to have no interest in me whatsoever. But you know, the fucking things that people do to each other. It's unfucking believable. Out of ignorance or just petty revenge? Or pride? Who knows what for? You know? Even just being in a relationship with someone else. You know, here's someone that I married that I love more than anyone that I've ever met in my life. And that there are those days where you just hate that person so much that you just can't imagine in your wildest dreams why you ever would have married someone like that. And then, you know, the next day it could be all... hugs and kisses and roses and you name it. Who knows? Maybe I'm just a little over emotional about the cell phone. You know, there are days when life's good and there are days when life just sucks. Sure, 90% of the time, I feel like days are pretty good. And there's just those one day out of every 10 that they just kind of suck. You know, it's like, what the fuck am I even here for?
Terribly remiss in doing this taping. The truth is, I hate filming myself very much. I don't mind growing the beard, but I do definitely mind talking about myself in front of a camera. All right, here I am. See this mole? This mole has hairs. Can you see the hairs growing out of this mole? Look at that. Oh my God. That's the nastiest thing. Isn't it interesting that you can have like a bunch of hair like this, and this is not gross. This is like hair, right? But just 3 hairs or 4 hairs coming out of a little spot on your body, gross.
I'm just babbling. This is bullshit. All I ever do on this camera is just talk about bullshit.
These wings come out. So what I'm hoping, I'm trying to kind of make them go down a little bit. So that it'll make kind of a beard, you know? Because I'm afraid what'll happen is I'll have these fucking yak things coming out of the sides like this right here. That's gonna be no good. And then my mustache, this isn't even as bad as most of the guys, but I mean, my upper lip is gone, right? So when I eat, it'll get in my mouth and it'll get stuck on my teeth. And as I chew, it'll pull out.
What the hell? I think I better do another stare. I don't think the other stare was good enough. For what?
Zebra.
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 Zebra. Zebra.
Zebra.
Zebra.
Zebra.
Zebra.
Zebra. Zebra.
Any stories, Dad? How about other people in Beth Shalom? Anyone that you know that you like?
No, not really. Because they are all, I'm indifferent about them because they have no character at all. And then a lot of people are dopey, you know?
Yeah.
They're absolutely out of their senses.
They are.
Many of them are daydreaming. They're zombies that walk around. And they don't know anybody or anything.
Is that because they lost their minds?
Well, temporarily, yes.
Well, I don't think it's temporary.
Well, they go through a period where they don't understand anything.
Yeah. Are there Alzheimer's patients on your wing?
Who knows what they are? It could be anything. I'm sure some, yeah.
What does Alzheimer's mean?
Yeah.
Alzheimer's is a disease of the brain.
Oh, the aging thing.
Yeah. Yeah, Alzheimer's is, I'm going to take this off, he doesn't need it just yet.
No, not yet.
Alzheimer's is a disease, Dad, that attacks your brain.
Yeah.
And over a matter of years, that's the people that will look at their children and not know who they are.
Yes, I know, they're totally dead. And most people are aware of the fact that I am the one that's... I'm normal, you see.
Yeah.
And the other people are not.
Yeah.
And so I show back up to work and I pull up in this brand new truck and, you know, immediately three or four of the guys like, wow, nice new truck. Where'd you get that? You know, oh, my father-in-law left it for us. And they're like, oh, lucky you. A lot of the guys that comment on it are just blown away by how hairy I am. I mean, the guy at the restaurant, I told him, yeah, it's a 4.5 month beard. And he goes, wow. You know, and I found that you can truly tell who your friends are when that happens. There is no fucking gray area. You can truly tell who are friends. Because when you come driving up in a new pickup truck that you just inherited from your dead father-in-law who you love and miss dearly, and people go, wow, that is a cool truck, you're so lucky, that says a lot about a person. You know, I think I've earned a lot of respect from men. You know, I guess I'm a very good beard grower. We'll call him Larry. Larry was a nice guy. He was a little... He was different. You could tell his brain didn't work like everybody else's. And apparently, I never got it straight from Larry, but apparently he took medication, you know, to help. And if he didn't take his medication, he was kind of unstable. But he always was a pretty nice guy, but, you know, the other construction guys didn't really like him. He was just too much for them, I guess. I don't know. Came the peace, you know, I was at peace with this vehicle and sort of with the situation. I said, you know what, fuck it. He gave us this truck, he wanted us to use it. I'm gonna run this fucker into the ground, man. I'm gonna drive this thing till the wheels fall off. Same thing, I roll up there and all the guys are like, wow, nice new truck, lucky you. And I saw Larry, and Larry said, "Hey, you know, that's a nice truck. Where, you know, where'd you get that? Did you just buy it?" And I said, "No, you know, my father-in-law just died, and he left it for us." And the first thing out of Larry's mouth was, "I'm really sorry to hear that." And he was genuine. It was genuine. As genuine as you could get. That was the first time I'd heard anybody say that. You know, there were some good friends that were... that were genuinely sad. But still, I think a lot of them were envious, too. They're like, "Lucky you. Because you got it made. You don't even know how good you got it made." And the truth is, I do. But all the money and the trucks in the world can't buy back a dead person. And if it happened to you, you'd use it just the same. It's not often I have to sit down and think about these things. You tend to kind of put them out of your mind.
If I had a cell phone when I was in high school, yes, I would have used it. Absolutely. You know, I was 16 years old, 17 years old. Anybody's going to use it if you give it to them. That's the thing. They're going to use it because it's there and it's immediate. And that's what we've created, a total age of immediacy. Shit, at this point, I'd welcome it. I'd welcome the cell phones, gone. Cell phone towers ripped down. The Wi-Fi access, get rid of it. I think that, like, instant messaging and iPods and MySpace and chat rooms and all that stuff, well, it's what Ray Bradbury warned us about in Fahrenheit 451, and he warned us about a shrinking of the language. And that's sad. I don't really feel like this gets an opportunity to know me at all. I mean, kind of it does. You can know about some of the things I'm into, I guess. I love theater, I love music, I love film. I play drums, I'm in a band, like that's just all stuff to know about someone, though. Get rid of the laptops, get rid of the, you know, and this isn't coming from a place, it sounds obviously like this is coming from a place of some freaky Earth First guy, but I don't feel like you can ever really get to know who anybody really truly is this way. You've got to be with that person, you've got to touch them and smell them and be around them. We're all experiencing this same thing, which seems so small and insignificant in comparison to the things that we could be going through together. But as is evidenced by the fact that somebody freaked out, I'm assuming, I still don't really know why Ben shaved, but I'm just assuming that he just freaked out, like just kind of bugged out. I can't do it. I can't handle it. I got to shave it. That's my assumption. And I could be wrong, but assuming that, I guess that sort of that kind of made it a bit more valid for me in terms of the struggle I was having inside with this, thinking, God, maybe I'm just a baby about this, but this is difficult to do. So it's a friendship contract, and if that were not looming over this, there's no fucking way I would be able to have this beard. I think it's ridiculous. It doesn't suit me at all. I look like a walking joke. I've become a caricature of a guy with a beard. And I didn't know growing up that maybe it took 5 years to grow a beard of this size. I didn't know because he always had it. And when he did trim it, you know, this was the smallest that it was for a lot of my growing up. This was like on the small end of my dad's beard. The thickness of it, it's like a briar patch. I mean, and this is the thing. I need you to be able to come to like leap through the camera and feel this thing. That's what I need for you to truly understand it. I need you to come through and grab the thing. I should put it up on eBay when I shave it. Or you know what I should have done? I should have put myself up on eBay while I still had it. Sold, you know, I'll come to your house and you can scratch my beard for an hour or something like that. The current state of politics and education, it's a nightmare. It's worse than it's probably ever been since, you know, Jefferson and Horace Mann were setting up the first schools. It's just pathetic right now. Maybe we'll get somebody else in the White House who will finally, I don't know, listen to the Constitution and put control of the schools back into the state, the hands of the state, because it's been robbed as much as they don't want to admit that. Come on, think about it. Really think about it. And we totally were able to get by for so long without cell phones. And I know that they've done some small degree of good, but those things are poison. Poison in the school systems. Papers turned in that say, that are written in IM speak. And the letter U stands for Y-O-U. These are new students to me. So of course I have to unteach, but it's coming from somewhere. Everything's got to be now. And if it's not now, I don't want it. I got to read a book. I don't want to read a book. I want to get on MySpace. These kids have computers in their bedrooms. They go home. They're supposed to be doing their homework. I don't want to do my homework. I'll turn on MySpace and chat with someone else. That was never an option. You know, I didn't have a telephone in my bedroom. You'd have to come down, go sit in the kitchen, get on the phone, talk for 5 minutes, 10 minutes maybe to set up whatever you were going to be doing later. But that was it. You know, there's no real communication anymore. It's not enough to even just have a video game anymore that you can go to the arcade and play. You've got to have it in the house. And not only does it have to be in the house, you got to be hooked up online playing with other people from around the world. Now that's a really cool technological advancement that's possible. I'm amazed that that's even possible. But who the fuck needs it? Nobody needs that. It's this ridiculous thing that it's a huge monster we're creating. And then if you add on top of it, the types of things that they have access to on any given day, from the porn to the violence. My other hope is that in 20 years, whether or not we still have cell phones, this is a plea to the parents of the world. More importantly, the parents of Auburn, California. Please stop calling your kids in class. That's my biggest hope and dream. Because 90% of the time when the cell phone goes off in class, in the middle of class, it's the parents. And that is ridiculous and totally unnecessary. There's no way that you can convince me that that needs to happen right now in class. Because it didn't happen for you. Whichever parent you are, there's no parent I know right now who is of an age that had cell phone capability when they were in high school. And there's no way that your parents called you when you were in the middle of class, sometimes daily. So stop, for the love of all that is good and sacred. Stop calling your children in class.
Breathe a second.
Come on, breathe a little bit. That's it. Got it.
If that was your last contraction, you'll have to do that. As soon as I get my gown on, you can go ahead and...
I'm just going to wash your hands.
Ow!
Okay, Susie, I'm so sorry.
Push.
I know, you're real sensitive.
Breathe. No, don't push. Breathe. Cold. Breathe. Neither did you notify the nursery.
Okay. Yeah, I just don't want this to...
And we had our baby last night, and that was a long night. And baby ended up going to ICU because it couldn't breathe on its own very well. Well, actually, when it came out, it wasn't breathing at all. So that was a little dicey, to be sure. And they put him, they gave him a couple breaths with a bag, and he started breathing on his own. Still not particularly well, though. And they took him over to ICU and hooked him up to various monitoring devices and whatnot. And I think we'll have him back in our room today. So looks like the dangerous part of it has passed, and he has started doing what he was supposed to be doing the entire time, which is living. I have to say, too, in a week, this beard here will go away. Also, this hair mole, look at that. That bad boy. That needs a trimming. Look at that. Oh, God. The horror of that.
All right, little man. Yay, you get to go home. Oh. 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 Oh, I know, huh?
I tell you what, though, it'll be better without the beard. It'll be better without the beard. That's for damn sure. I believe that I'll be happier without my beard than I am with my beard. That's powerful, you know?
I am uncomfortable. Here's the thing. Is it still recording?
This is important. 53 minutes.
I am still uncomfortable. I still hate my beard. It has not changed. Wait! I just realized something. You know what I just realized? Today is May 1st. You know what that means? I've been growing a beard for 6 months. Ha! Ha! What do you think of that? Huh? 6 months. Huh? Yeah. I said it before. I said it in there. It was all dark. And I'm going to say it again. Those of you watching this film right now, you men out there, you men who think this is no big deal. Oh, what's a big deal? Yeah, what's a big deal? They're growing beards. No, that's not the case. I tell you what, what's the date? Ask yourself, what's the date? What day are you watching this on? Let's say October 3rd. Is it October 3rd? All right, October to November, November to December, January, February, March, April. Is that right? Yeah, you get to shave on April 1st, April 3rd. How's that? Deal? We'll see who's talking, man. It's not easy. No trimming, remember? No joke. 6 months. Ha! Look at us, man. Congratulations, Mike Schwartz. Congratulations. 6 months, motherfucker.
Like I look like a gorilla. It's the most I've looked like a primate in my life. I'm sitting here right now. This is beautiful. I'm sitting by the American River, and it's the river. The sun's at such a point that the river looks like it's totally black, and the reflections are totally gold. It's like a black and gold river. Canyon rises up 300 feet in the span of 50. It's a 70 degree angle. All around. This kind of place gets me thinking about living down here. I wish I would have done all my interviews outside.
I had life stuff and I had, you know, ups and downs over 6 months, but I don't think it's anything beyond what a normal 6 months would be in someone's life.
Yeah.
You know, my life next is a big question mark. And it's so funny because I think I said that about my life for these 6 months is a big question mark, and I don't know if I have any periods or exclamation points to put at the end of these 6 months either. I don't know if there's, it's just, my life happened for 6 months and it's not like anything just stopped or anything happened right now or in the last week. It's just, my life is gonna be pretty much the same except I don't have a beard, I think. I'm really eager to get this beard off and go in the water. That's what
Look
I wanna do.
Look at that water right now.
Yeah, we've been doing genetic counseling to try to figure out what's wrong with me that's creating these kids that are in the autism spectrum. And autism is one of those things where they don't know what combination of genes is creating it, so they can't trace it to a specific gene set. I've learned a lot about myself doing this film, that's for sure. I learned that I'm not as confident as I thought I was. This is the death of Jason Long with the beard.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. It's probably true forever, man. I mean, unless you guys ever decide to have us do some 20-year thing,
yeah,
I'm not growing a beard again.
How old are you now, 20 years?
53. I'll do it in 20 years.
Oh yeah.
If it comes to that, but other than that, man, I'm not doing it. No fucking way. Well, it's weird considering our context we have.
Yeah.
We have a context that most people just don't have. I mean, few people do, and you've seen him. We've all seen him. We've all made eye contact with some guy with a beard, and just given a little nod. There's a little understanding.
Yeah.
And I never would have thought in a million years that I looked weird, clean shaven. And I guarantee, in 20 minutes, I'm gonna look fucking weird. I'm planning on using the three here for my sides because I can't, it's useless in here for me and down here. And I'm going to use those other five fucking twos around the rest of the thing. I've also got two pair of scissors. Christian's got my white scissors and I've got a little tiny pair of scissors. And I'm going to go two-handed and just fucking get in there and do it. I think he's torn. I feel like there's a part of him that has probably always wanted me to grow a beard. He just kind of looked at me and he was like, "Nah, you gotta get rid of that thing. I don't like it. I don't like it." Despite what Reed says, I don't really think it suits me, personally. I'm not saying I didn't grow an okay beard over here, this guy, the beard grower, but it doesn't suit me.
By the way, my footage of my small object was
close. People surprise me every day. I'm amazed sometimes. Some fucking talented friends, man. I think I just gotta sort through some things. You know, when I get back home, I get to kind of slow down a little bit. I don't have school and I can spend more time with my daughter. I really, you know, wanna focus on doing some quality things with her. And I never realized just how special it was to have a healthy child. Just to have a baby that comes out that's healthy and good looking, and that's a big, big deal. I feel really good about my beard. I mean, not to knock Dan, but man, that's not a great beard. And I think mine is proportional. I mean, out of the whole bunch, I really am proud of my beard. I don't have any funny, funky spots. It's even. It's.
I
like my beard best. I mean, I like Jason's, man. That's an impressive beard, but that's too much. Yours is not proportional. Reed's is not too bad, it's pretty even, but I feel like mine is, my face is, looks good with a beard.
You ever want to ask someone, if you're doing okay? I don't know who you'd ask. Someone objective, someone independent, not one of your buddies. Like, I guess that's what one of those life coaches are, but I don't want that. But just to be like, what do you think? Am I doing okay? Have I made the right decisions? Am I fucking up? I got these rocks digging into my ass. It's horrible. I'm also a little scared of the rattlesnakes here. It's a hard thing to dedicate yourself to living a good and true life. Is that right? I hope that doesn't sound stupid, but like, I want to live fully, experience fully, be true, be honest to myself, honest to those around me, and good to people. Do good things. Just do. No, good's the wrong word. That gets too, that's almost religious. I'm done with that phase. Oh, I'm just talking. I don't want to shave. I don't want the beard necessarily, but I don't want to shave.
You know, it's like as though one day I just couldn't sing anymore and my voice was no longer something I had in my repertoire to give, or my guitar playing, or my carpentry. Looks have just kind of failed me. Is that, they haven't failed me. I know that I'm not, it's just that it's a strange thing having been very attractive, I think, at one point in my life. And now, you know, I'm attractive. Sort of. I don't know, man. Vanity is a weird thing. Vanity. And it's particularly weird because it seems like women on the whole don't really care. Women see right past it, man. They can see a good, well, I shouldn't say that on the whole. But I think they women have the good man sensor. You know, they're much more concerned about the man behind the face. I struggle with it a little bit. It's sad to watch yourself lose your youth, get less. Some people age attractively. I'm not that. Oh man, it hurts. For all of the women in the world who've never done this, man, this hurts. I mean, it's not like childbirth. It hurts. I'm so sensitive. I didn't realize it was so emotional, so emotionally attached to this thing. It's hard not to believe in God when you're in a place like this. Although I'm sure he's looking down going, what, man, this is not what I intended. I did not intend for my people to do this. Froggy. Man, they know what time it is. I hear three. I hear exactly three of them.
Mm-hmm.